And greetings, happy Friday. Welcome to the Steve Deace Show, live and on demand here on BlazeTV, radio and podcast. I'm Steve Deace. Todd Erzin is here, as is Aaron McIntyre. It has been a while, but it is good to have our friend Shannon Joy back. She'll be joining us here momentarily. For the Deace Group, let us know what you think about what we think. Steve at stevedeace.com. That's how you can email the program, D-E-A-C-E. Like us on Facebook. Follow us on Twitter, at Steve Deace Show. Look for my name as well on MeWe, Parler, and Gab. Somebody asked me the other day, why do you have so few followers on Gab? I think we're at less than 5,000 there. I don't know. I don't know. Are we getting shadow banned now on the alternative sites? The alternative sites are now shadow banning us. Think that might have something to do with it, or maybe we're just not. It could also be we're just not that popular.
I think there's something else. And this is, if people are like me, like how many like streaming services do I need?
Yeah,
to
how many
subscribe?
Can I
like,
do?
People
right.
are just like I gotta have a life. I'm tapping out at some point.
Yeah, but that's they still have a couple million users there. So for us to only have, or for me to only have, you know, 4,900 something. Well,
the product
is pretty
may
pathetic,
be outstanding.
To be brutally
I'm just
honest.
Saying, at some point we just are like
I hear you.
I'm out.
And maybe they're thinking, hey, our algorithm of Gab is promoting enough people. Why would we? You know, there's only so many people we can promote. You didn't make the cut. That could be it too, right? That's possible.
Yeah.
All right. You can look for clips of the show over at rumble.com/Steve Deace Show. Again, that's rumble.com/Steve Deace Show. Also, we talked yesterday on the program about how that poor man, Jack Phillips, again, tragically, the only cake baker in all of Denver, Colorado, back in the courts again. The group that is defending him is the same one that did it successfully all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court before, and that is Alliance Defending Freedom. If you want to get involved in the fight to help Jack beat them again, because this is probably going to the U.S. Supreme Court too, and this goes back to what we said about that ruling. Yes, he did win. But remember, they didn't grant Jack a victory on the premise of his argument. They granted it on the premise that the way he was being mistreated was yucky and nasty, and that if the state of Colorado could come up with any rationale beyond religious animus, then they could absolutely put their boot to his throat, right?
Yes.
So I read some of the 9-0 ruling on the Catholic adoption or foster program agency. Or it was the adoption agency.
Adoption,
right?
Yeah.
I read some of that some on that ruling yesterday. That was 9-0. Guess what I found? It's virtually the exact same ruling. Yeah. That and chances are they probably could have gotten 5 or 6 votes by just slapping it down on the premise. But I guess for some reason John Roberts decided he wanted a 9-0. Verdict, and the way that they got it was saying that they were just individually unfair to this particular group. Didn't set any precedent that said Catholic adoption agencies are free to actually be Catholic. They just said you're being nasty to this one. You're picking on this one. It's very similar to the Jack Phillips win. Mm. I mean, it's a win. It's a win.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. It's a win. You at least got, you know, a few lefty spirit of the agers on the court to admit that there's even a line they don't want to cross, right? You got that, but it's a pretty narrow in scope win, which is why there might be a round two where that fight is concerned as well. If you want to get involved, adflegal.org/Steve, that's how you can help to defend Jack, who's being represented pro bono by Alliance Defending Freedom. So they need resources, and they get them from people like us at adflegal.org/Steve. Of course, it's a Friday. That means Feedback Friday, coming your way in the next hour of the show. But we begin this hour, as we always do, with the Deace Group. Alongside New York talk show host Shannon Joy, good to see you again. Let's get to issue one. Bleep, Lord Nefarious says.
Maybe somebody took it from the wild, put it in the lab, and then it escaped from the lab. But that means it was in the wild to begin with. So that's why I don't get what they're talking about.
Even though you lean towards feeling that this is more likely a natural occurrence, we always felt that you've got to keep an open mind, all of us. We didn't get up and start announcing it, but we've always said keep an open mind and continue to look. So I think it's a bit of a distortion to say that we deliberately suppress that.
The state mandates that have proven right and correct and brought us through this pandemic are relaxed as of today.
We all need to look at one another and ask ourselves, what do we need to do better next time? And in many respects, being able to sacrifice a little bit for one another to get through this and to save more lives is going to be essential, and that's something that I think we could all have done a little bit better on.
Today feeling okay, wow, this is new. Got the vaccine and it's been 2 weeks. There's life in the streets, hot people at brunch, and I've got a hunch mimosas are gonna be bottomless. Turning off Zoom after 15 long months stuck on mute. No lockdowns anymore. We can finally walk out the door.
Doesn't it just fill you with pride, showing who you are on the inside?
It's kind of scary because I only realized this a couple of days ago, and I've only come out to a few people. I'm a guy.
In this case, he was not sexually harassing anybody. He didn't have the intent to sexually harass somebody. He was sexually harassing himself.
The Supreme Court this fall will review a Mississippi law that bans most abortions after 15 weeks of pregnancy. Is an unborn baby at 15 weeks a human being?
Let me just say that I'm a big supporter of Roe v. Wade. I am a mother of 5 children in 6 years. I think I have some standing on this issue as to respecting a woman's right to choose.
Is it a human being?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Tiffany, and I am a former fetus. On behalf of all fetuses, I would just like to say, please abort us. We don't want to be here.
We're building back better together, and I'm building back greener, I'm building back fairer, and building back more equal, and in a more gender neutral and perhaps like a more feminine way. How about that?
That dude has a very, very punchable face. Like, repetitively tenderized.
Like, Tony Stark's Hulk suit on Hulk.
Yeah. Yeah. Very, very punchable. Metaphorically speaking, of course. Yeah. Todd?
Shannon is exactly right and really put that well in terms of not knowing whether we're jumping the shark or we're about to get squashed like a bug. The answer is yes. We are on the razor's edge right now. That's why the whole notions of going back to normal, total insanity and reality, the Venn diagram of that is almost just a circle right now. Mm-hmm. And so hopefully as many people are going to wake up because of that as we can, and we still have a chance, but it means that there's also very little time left. And I speak to that. My worst of the week is the rainbow singing parade. What's going on there? Because we ever heard of a COVID? How many times did I tell you? Once you believe in this gender nonsense, you will believe anything. And I've never been more right about anything in life. You remember Fellowship of the Ring or Boromir when the fellowship's being formed and he's talking about there is evil here that does not sleep. Well, there is weakness here that does not sleep. And where are the men? There they are. And that's pathetic.
Aaron.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's Andrew Cuomo finally relaxing the state's guidelines or ending them, saying that the state mandates have worked. I'm not sure. I just think you have to be in denial at this point about the state of our culture to think that he's ever going to be held accountable for this.
Yep.
I think you're in denial. No matter how many scapegoats they may need, they don't care. They don't care.
Nope.
Unless there is just some acute point of hey, we got to get this, just to get through this day. We got to get rid of something. We got to do something. But that's not coming. They can ride out anything that they want to. The left can. The spirit of the age thinks that it can anyway. And so it's going to continue doing so until we force them and we force accountability and actual justice, not just vindication.
Let's get to the exit question. On a scale of 1 to 10, with 1 being your confidence Joe Biden is actually running the country, and 10 being your confidence we'll never see him on that sort of international stage like we did this past week, where it was a disaster minute ever again, given that performance. Rank this week's level of total depravity, Todd.
10.
Shannon?
10.
Oh, you got a 10 from Shannon. Aaron?
10.
You know, this is the time of year we celebrate our independence and the values that made America great. Now more than ever, though, it's important to make sure we support companies that support those values as well. Shannon was just talking about what corporate America is trying to impose against us, for example, in a lot of places. That's why, you know, a lot of us, pretty much everybody, needs a mobile phone these days. Give it a shot with Patriot Mobile. They not only share your beliefs, they stand behind it with action. They're America's only conservative wireless carrier, and they donate a portion of all of your dollars to organizations that fight for the causes that we fight for on shows like this. You also get no hidden fees, cheaper rates, the same coverage that everybody else offers, because they offer the same, they use the same towers that everybody else does. And right now they've got two offers for you to make the switch. Get 50% off your first 2 months, or you can choose $100 off a new phone if you want to go that route instead. So either 100 off your next phone or 50% off your first 2 months of service when you go to patriotmobile.com/Steve. That's patriotmobile.com/Steve. Remember, veterans and first responders, let them know who you are. You get even more savings. Patriotmobile.com/Steve, or you can call their top-rated customer service team at 972-PATRIOT. That's 972-PATRIOT. Let's get to issue two here on the Deace Group, Biden versus Putin.
Joe Biden and Russian President Vladimir Putin had a much-hyped meeting this week. It started with Joe Biden being asked about comments he's made in the past regarding Putin.
To answer the first question, I'm laughing too. Well, look, I mean, he has made clear that the answer is, I believe he has in the past essentially acknowledged that he was, there are certain things that he would do or did do.
Putin granted a 90-minute interview to NBC News where he said this, among other things.
We don't have this kind of habit of assassinating anybody. That's one. Number two is, I want to ask you, did you order the assassination of the woman who walked into the Congress and who was shot and killed by a policeman? Do you know that 450 individuals were arrested after entering the Congress? And they didn't go there to steal a laptop. They came with political demands. 450 people have been detained. They're looking at jail time between 15 and 25 years, and they came to the Congress with political demands. Isn't that prosecution for political opinions?
The meeting came and went, was shorter than expected, and Biden said he and Putin talked about many things, including cybersecurity, and said he gave the Russians a list of things to absolutely not hack.
I talked about the proposition that certain critical infrastructure should be off limits to attack, period, by cyber or any other means. I gave them a list, if I'm not mistaken, I don't have it in front of me, 16 specific entities. 16 defined as critical infrastructure under U.S. policy, from the energy sector to our water systems.
And so, if they don't care, what happens? If they don't care, what happens? What happens? Let's get to a true false for the first question, because we pride ourselves in being intellectually honest and consistent on the show as best as we can, given our own sinfulness and frailties as mere human beings. But I think it's well established within the lexicon of this program. I was not, shall we say, approving of the behavior the former president often exhibited, where the butcher of Pyongyang was concerned. Is that fair?
Yes.
Okay. So let's start there. True or false? This past week was even more embarrassing than Trump's testicle scrubbing of the North Korean butcher, Todd.
True. Mm. And it's not even close.
Really?
It's not even close. I know. Okay. Personally, that just hit a spot, so I can see why you might think it's close. I just always saw it more in the vein of Trump being Trump on just about everything. And I've got my unique frustrations with Trump too. But this, Steve, you just sat next to me. You saw me run through the gamut of emotions. Like I had to put my head down at Biden with that long pause. Mm-hmm. I couldn't even watch it. It's so embarrassing. And then the second part, when Putin gives a speech about January 6th in the Capitol, I am the GIF of that guy who's holding the lawn chair and he flaps it out and sits down like, yes, I am here for this. and then the third part, I'm laughing because the president itemizes the list of things he's going to beg you not to attack. Well, I'm just guessing that if Putin is really the bad actor, you say he is, and he may very well be, or China or whoever. Note to self, those might be the things they attack first.
Yes.
So yeah, by a long shot, this was way more embarrassing.
It's just like Reagan showing up at Reykjavik with a list of places for Gorbachev to not point their missiles because our defense grid is weak here, right?
What is this? Shannon, China have a country here.
Shannon, what are your thoughts?
I don't know what to make of this. I don't know what to make of Putin. I the answer is true, first and foremost, because it seems as if Putin is way more concerned about the fascism in the United States of America than 99% of our elected Republicans.
Yep. Or just to clarify, he's far more willing to exploit it for his own political gain than right. even Republicans are willing to do that yeah. to defend their own voters.
Yeah.
Yes, it's at least that. Yes.
I'm going to be honest. I mean, I pay close attention. I didn't really, until Tucker talked about the 100 or more political prisoners in Washington, D.C., it was not even on my radar. I mean, I was shocked about that, to be honest. The thing about Putin, I feel like I have a cat, his name is Rocky. When he hunts a mouse or he gets a chipmunk, he bats it around a little bit. He doesn't kill it. He just like plays with it and he bats it around and just has fun with it. And I feel as if it's become an American tradition for Putin to humiliate our presidents and just like bat them around, you know, even with Obama, with the I'll have more flexibility on mm-hmm. the live mic after the election to, as you mentioned, Trump, you know, brown nosing and sucking up to him at every corner to now Biden. So it's, I don't know how seriously to take it, except for to me, it almost feels like a show, you know, and if Putin is the cat and we're the chipmunk, then what I'm concerned about the Rottweiler that is China and G7 and the Great Reset and all, you know, all the other entities that are really shaping the disaster that we are in right now in this country and in the world that we're not even talking about. We're not even really, we're talking about a little bit more, thank God. But, you know, that's my concern. So yeah, it's worse, but I guess I'm just used to the razzle dazzle.
I mean, we couldn't get in 8 months later, Georgia is admitting in one of its largest counties that it cannot provide chain of custody for 25% of 142,000 plus mail-in votes. Which begs the question, what in the Sam Hill were they auditing all those times last year that they kept telling us? Well, it's like our second audit, our third audit. What were you auditing? If you are just now learning, 8 months in, one of your largest counties could not provide ample chain of custody of a ballot for 25% of the cases for over 142,000 ballots. What in a state decided by 11,170 votes? What in the world were you auditing? We can't get the Republican Party nationally to move on that. We can't get the Republican Party nationally to move on the fact about 100 of its own voters are just sitting indefinitely detained without being charged of any crime in a jail cell. We can't get them to do that. But we did get the Republican Party to move instantly on making Juneteenth a federal holiday when it has been a state holiday already for 40 years. And our first two black presidents, hat tip Toni Morrison, Bill Clinton, and then Barack Obama, they had all Democrat Congresses, didn't seem to care about making Juneteenth a national holiday. But because some consultant, by the way, I think the Republican Party probably should have made Juneteenth a national holiday during like Reconstruction when Democrats were still trying to impose slavery by another means called Jim Crow, right? Maybe that might have been a smart play, but this is just a clearly contrived attempt that some consultant somewhere said, you're going to get like 0.000472 more of the black vote if you do this. And Joy Reid will only call you racist 14 times this week when she had it really on her list to do it 21, right? That we had to move heaven and earth for this, but people, just citizens, just sit indefinitely detained without anything being charged.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, and Georgia is just now telling us that one county's results could literally flip the outcome of the entire state 8 months later.
You just channeled one of the conversations Frank Luntz and Kevin McCarthy had at one of their sleepovers.
Oh, now you just want me to start. Start dealing with punchable faces when you tell me stuff like that.
Yes, I do.
Aaron, what do you think?
So I think to me, it's false by a hair, because there's an excuse for Biden this week. It's called dementia. You know, it's one thing if you get your pants pulled down by Vladimir Putin. It's another thing if you actively pull down your pants to the butcher of Pyongyang.
Right, right.
So to me, that makes Trump's humping the leg of what's his face, Kim Jong-un.
Mm-hmm.
That makes it a little bit worse, but it is, in a sense, I can definitely make the case that this week is worse just based on the fact that this guy is Joe Biden. He is just a puppet at best, of the people around him. At worst, he's just completely vacant.
So you guys know how much, I mean, maybe the last time in my life CNN is ever going to call me and ask me to come on the air was to comment on Trump's behavior with Kim Jong-un, because you guys know how much that bothered me, right? That my level of disdain for that reached a proportion that even CNN thought, we can put this on our airwaves.
Yes. So
it fits with our overall programming, okay? That aside, though, at first when you instantly said that it was true, I kind of was like, really? The more and more I think about it, and it's actually because of what you said, Aaron, I think if I had gone first, I would have voted false, just because I still have ticks. I mean, like a tick reaction just thinking about it. But what we saw this week on a world stage, with the entire industrialized world watching, and in the company of other leaders of equal, or in the case of Macron, who was dressing him down, lesser influence, is a word that I don't think we could ever associate with a U.S. president before. We've had incompetence, Jimmy Carter. We've had corruption, Nixon, Harding, right? Okay.
Yeah.
We've had communist, Obama. I mean, we've had people that were some various form of ne'er-do-well, correct?
Yes.
Have we ever had feeble?
Mm.
And to me, this last week, we projected as a country feebleness to the world.
Yes, we did.
Okay? Like, say what you want about Jimmy Carter. He was incompetent, but like, he backed out of the Moscow Olympics. He tried to actually rescue the hostages. The operation was a disaster,
mm-hmm.
Okay? But he did send like military people in. He tried, okay?
Yeah.
This is feeble. It's feebleness. That, have we ever, in the history of this republic, projected anything close to that word? First of all, is that word fair?
Yes.
And have we projected anything close to that word to the world in the history of our nation?
I don't believe so.
Shannon, I'll give you a minute. What are your thoughts on that?
No, I don't think so. And I think that what this is indicative of is the complete breakdown at the federal level. All politicians, our presidents, our bureaucracies. I mean, there is absolutely no leadership at the top. There's no vision at the top. From my perspective, it's a mess of lazy and unimaginative, some of them corrupt, some of them incompetent, all running around with their heads cut off. They don't know what to do. They're taking directions from someone. I don't know who. It's clearly not the people we elected to be in
charge. Right. You just described District 1 in the Hunger Games. You just described the Capitol, basically. Yeah. Yeah. But the spirit of the age is President Snow.
Mess. Yeah. I mean, hopefully, bottom up, hopefully this opens up an opportunity for local organization and a renaissance in self-governing, which we're seeing.
Let's get to the exit question. If the likelihood, my January prediction that Joe Biden will not finish the year as president, were an Eagles song in honor of this being the 49th anniversary of their debut album, which Eagles song would it be? A, The Long Run, B, Take It to the Limit, or C, Already Gone? Todd?
Take It to the Limit.
Shannon, what do you think?
Take It to the Limit.
All right, so you guys think he's going to survive?
Well,
Aaron?
Take It to the Limit.
Okay.
I took that to mean we're not going to know until December 31st, basically.
Oh, you think it will go that? Okay.
I just say exactly what the person before me says, because I never understand these anyway. Well, that's my policy.
There we go. Honesty. All right, speaking of which, when we come back, all they do is lie. Next. Guess what I just had? That's right. Built Bar is back in the house. Snacking isn't always the best thing in the world when it comes to your health, unless it is a Built Bar. It is the most nutritious snack you've ever had in terms of what actually tastes good. And then it tastes better. I just had, again, one of the chocolate chip cookie dough ones, and I learned my lesson. I brought a couple in extra today just to have a stash over there in case I ever forget my daily furnishing of these again. It fits into any healthy lifestyle, low carb, low sugar, low-cal. Even the most decadent flavor they've made yet, the chocolate chip cookie dough one, still just 170 calories, still just 7 net carbs, 7 grams of sugar. That's it for something that tastes better than a lot of the candy bars that are out there. All right, and they've got a ton of flavors, and most of them, by the way, are 130 calories or less, all of them covered in real chocolate banana nut bread. I did jump online and get one of those yesterday when it was for sale for just one day. Little tip on the dough prime, tomorrow and Sunday, they will have a special caramel brownie Father's Day flavor. You can go online and order as well. BuiltBar.com, B-U-I-L-T is how it's spelled. Get 15% off your order when you use my last name, Deace, as your promo code at BuiltBar.com. BuiltBar.com, promo code Deace. Let's welcome back in our good friend Shannon Joy as we continue on with our weekly look at the week that was. Let's get to issue 3. All they do is lie.
Last week, the CDC...
Let's get the issue for you. Have an intro for this one. We're just going right to the conversation.
Go right to the conversation.
All right. So we already brought up the whole Juneteenth thing. All right. So this is our next instant racist detector, apparently. Okay. So if anything, this thing should have been like a holiday like 100 years ago, and Republicans should have done it during Reconstruction to rub it in the face of the Jim Crow KKK South, right? Why is it being done now when it wasn't done with the first, according to Toni Morrison, black president Bill Clinton, when he had entire Democrat legislatures or congresses? Why wasn't it done under Barack Obama, the actual first black president, when they had a filibuster-proof majority in the U.S. Senate? All right. And why are we rushing to do it now? And why are Republicans who can't be bothered about their own voters being indefinitely detained rushing to do this now? It's just all a contrivance, right? Okay. Mm-hmm. So you can take this seriously or go on a contrivance. What will be the next federal holiday, Todd?
I don't know what will be the next, but that was the question was what should be? It should be my birthday, because I identify as the greatest human who has ever breathed oxygen in the history of man. done. You must bend the knee to that. You must accept that. My pronoun is I am awesome. That should be the federal holiday.
I like it. You are awesome.
All right, so Shannon, I'm going to make you follow that like I made him follow you last round. Go ahead.
Well, so I think that this Juneteenth thing is kind of interesting. And I think the reason that they're doing it has to do with the FDA and the trouble with the vaccines. I do know that there is a lot of angst within the FDA right now, a lot of turmoil. It's a bit frenzied. The risk profile on this vaccine, the cat's kind of out of the bag. The cow's out of the barn on this. I don't know if they can put it back in. And so we know that the FDA is split on this idea about recommending it for children or whether, you know, it's safe for children. And I think I have just a hunch that they might have just thrown this out so that they did not have to have this meeting today, which was Friday, so that they could delay a little bit more, because I don't know. I think something is up there. So, I don't know. Next holiday should be the Shannon Joy is awesome holiday as well, because I breathe the best oxygen. And just to follow up on, you know, right. I just copy what you say.
Aaron?
Christmas.
Nice. I'm going to go first 2 days of the NCAA basketball tournament. Yeah. What do you think?
But it's so
save another couple days of vacation time, though, right?
Yeah.
All right, quickly, we got 2 minutes. Let's do predictions. Aaron, I'll start with you.
I had one from last week, but I realized it was a forced prediction, and I can't remember it now. So now I have to make something up off the top of my head. I think by the end of the summer, we will start to hear, by the end of the summer, meaning by the end of July, early to mid-August, we will start to hear active conversations about the 25th Amendment. I think Biden lasts through the end of the year. That's why I answered this way I did at the previous exit question. But we will start to hear active conversations about the 25th Amendment. Hey, what is this? Well, we found this scroll over in the White House. It says 25th Amendment. Wow. You're going to start to hear, what is this type of conversations by the end of the summer.
Somebody should ask Kamala Harris, have you ever thought about invoking the 25th Amendment? See if she does that laugh she always does when she lies. Oh, of course not. Which means yes. All right, Todd, go ahead.
In largely white suburban districts across the country this coming fall and winter, I think you are going to have teacher strikes. Those teachers are going to lash back and push back against CRT, and those teachers are going to strike, and they are going to frame CRT as a public health issue.
Can completely see that. Yeah. Can completely see that. Shannon, quickly, go ahead. Got about 30 seconds.
Yep. I think by this summer, we are going to see the vaccines suspended for use in children, to piggyback on what I was saying about the FDA. I think that the wheels are falling off this jalopy, and the adverse events and the deaths are way too high, way too high. They can't keep a lid on it.
I could see that as well. Yep.
Yeah.
You're seeing it in European countries now already. I could see that as well. I think my prediction is this fall, we are going to see another form of a credit or lending bubble / crisis, similar to what we saw in 2008. I look at the amount of debt they're servicing, the Fed is, in their repo markets, $235 billion in one day earlier this week, in one day. All right. Now, those numbers are way beyond where we were in 08, but it's a trend line very similar to what happened that portended what was going to happen in the fall of 2008. And I think we might be looking at another one of those now. So, you know what? I bought the house I'm in now a year or two before I could afford it, because I've read some market analysis that said you might be stuck in the home you're in if you don't move now. So that's why we did. I might give the rest of you all that advice. Okay. And that's not a live read for real estate agents I trust. It's just looking at where things are heading. I might consider that if I were in other people's shoes in this day and age. Mm-hmm. Shannon, good to see you as always. All right. Take care. God bless.
Thanks, fellas.
You bet. Good to see you again. We'll come back with hour two, and it will be your turn with some Feedback Friday. We look forward to it next.
Thanks, guys.
Back with Hour 2, live and on demand on Blaze TV, radio, podcast. Steve Deace here with Aaron McIntyre, Totters, and all of you. Let us know what you think about what we think via the SteveDeace.com inbox. Email the program, steve@stevedeace.com. That's D-E-A-C-E. Like us on Facebook, MeWe, Parler, Gab. Look for Steve Deace in all of those places. Follow me on Twitter, at Steve Deace Show. And if you're looking for clips of the show, you can find them on rumble.com/SteveDeaceShow. Also, if you're a podcast listener, thank you. We're looking for you to hit that subscribe button for us if you haven't already. Leave us a 5-star review if you haven't done so already. Thank you to all of you that have done those things for us already, because you have already helped contribute to the growth of the program, and we appreciate that very much. Let's get to some feedback. Friday brought to you by our friends over at Tommy John. This summer, soak up the sun and not your sweat. Tommy John underwear is your solution to not feeling sticky, because its cool cotton fabric is 2 to 3 times cooler than regular cotton. And you can get a new pair of Tommy John underwear. Let your buns breathe. Keep your chicks chilled. Ice your cubes, you know, all the other various metaphors we can come up with. Use this underwear all summer long. Dozens of comfort innovations. It's a fantastic product. It's the only underwear I own now. Not that anybody asked. Might be a little too much TMI, but I kind of feel like if I'm going to suggest people purchase a product that covers their more intimate regions, I maybe should have some personal experience with it. Is that fair?
As long as the picture up on our screen isn't...
Say that again. Your mic was off. Go ahead.
As long as the picture up on the screen isn't you in your underwear, I'm good with that.
Okay. So an audible reference to it is okay?
Yeah, I'm fine.
All right, perfect. Audibly, then, I won't physically demonstrate it, but audibly, I would give you a very high recommendation. I'm not alone. They've been around for 13 years, thousands upon thousands of 5-star reviews, calling Tommy John the most comfortable underwear ever. Over 15 million pairs sold across the U.S. And right now, you can get 20% off your first order. If you've never tried it before, 20% off your first order at TommyJohn.com/Steve. 20% off your first order at TommyJohn.com/Steve. That's TommyJohn.com/Steve. So Feedback Friday, I'm like backloaded with feedback. So here's how we're going to handle this week. I'm going to share the feedback, and then it's going to be you two who respond, who pontificate on it. And as best I can, I can't promise I will offer no ensuing commentary, but I'm going to do my darndest to have you guys be who responds here. Okay?
Cool.
Because I've kind of done a little editorializing by suggesting what we're going to be responding to, right?
Sure, by the very act of reading the letters.
Yes. Sure. All right, so that might help us, keeping my long-windedness out of this, might help us put a dent in what's a pretty sizable stack right now. Okay? Aaron, you all right with that?
Absolutely.
All right, so I mean, Aaron, I told Aaron he could talk more, so absolutely, he's okay with that. All right, let's start here. I am a trained and practicing scientist. I practice hard science at a global corporation. But obviously, I've done academic research in the past. I can tell you that your letters from last week's Feedback Friday are correct. Everything about modern science is a narrative. Very few scientists, if any, are looking for objective observations. The few who are do not have a materialistic worldview most of the time, but are actually Christians. For the materialists, science, naturalism, that's their religion. Oftentimes, it doesn't matter what the facts are, the inputs or the hypotheses, and the outputs or the results must be consistent with their religion, or the results are just simply invalid and discarded. All modern science, he says, is narrative. A great example with this is the current Wuhan narrative. The clue is in how the lab-generated genome was detected. In modern virology, to detect a novel virus, the supposed infected material is run through a PCR test. That's a molecular test. After the PCR test, the results are the novel genome. The most glaring issue with this is that there must be a prior hypothesis to test for. In other words, someone predetermines the specific genome to test for. They were specifically testing for the lab hypothesis. Furthermore, meaning that the idea that the virus originated in the lab. Furthermore, if you read the paper, they used a cycle threshold of 30. Any value over 24 will produce significant false positives, with false positives being almost 100% when you get to 34 cycles or beyond, meaning people that may even have some artifact or trace of the virus, but it's just not any form of a transmissible or infectious danger. They specifically designed the test to produce these results that they wanted. If I told you how common this is in modern science, you probably would not believe me. The spirit of the age has been waiting to use this narrative for almost a year. Why? I don't have room in this letter. However, he is always a liar and cannot tell the truth. More importantly, we must compare this to the scriptures. Consider the smoking gun email, where they discuss the man-made origin of the virus. He says that the virus probably does not fit evolutionary theory. Yeah, I picked up on that too. I have been shouting for more than a year now that this is all about evolution. The term novel is an evolutionary term in biology. This virus recently evolved, and humans haven't evolved immunity yet. That is, evolution has left us helpless and not good. Even the discussion around variants implies evolution. However, if they find the variants using the methods described above, they can find anything they want, as long as it matches their religion of evolution. Everyone is standing around waiting for salvation from the Darwinists, but that's an altar that won't light. Remember, he's always a liar and cannot tell the truth. That is from Jacob Jackson, PhD.
Well, in a way, Steve, you already did comment on this, so I will point to your words that other people will be reading soon. Your latest column is very much about this issue. Listen, before all these guys got their master's degrees in some strain of science or even a PhD, before that, they got their undergrad in woke, whether with their bachelor's often, or just by going to high school, or starting off in kindergarten. That is the religious sensibility that was established well before any of them had some sort of awakening that they were going into the sciences, which is why those sciences are not hard or objective. They are as malleable as anything else. They are as malleable as pronouns to these people, which means you aren't dealing with anything remotely close to science, but incredibly dangerous because of how science, the pride of place, the amount of respect it has, it's used very much, and it's increasingly not how the Constitution more and more is like, yeah, whatever, in many progressive circles, but that's a relatively recent development. But the Constitution, for most of Steve and my life, and we each had an awakening about that to some degree, was used as a tool to get what it wanted to, but otherwise ignored as much as possible. That's kind of how science is used now in many, many respects, and scientists. There's something else afoot. It's not an end, it's a means.
Science has become the opening line of, I think it's the opening line of 1984. It was a bright, cold day in April, and the strikes were all striking 13. It's a commentary on not the clocks itself, but the nature of what truth is and how we mark things and measure things. And that's fundamentally what science is. It's a measurement of things, an observation of measurements over time. And you can finagle outcomes. You can start from faulty premises if you want to, in order to reach the outcomes that you want. The science starts with an outcome first and works backward. Words. Science, real science, starts by observation and reaches an outcome. If you want to know why, have you seen some of the stories in recent years? One comes to mind, notably from Seattle, I believe it was, the public school district, or at least one school there, was discussing the idea of numbers being racist. Not the idea of the outcome of numbers, but numbers themselves. They are a relic of the patriarchy, or the white of white culture, something along those lines. Why would the racialists even try to attempt? Why would the spirit of the age even try to attempt to paint something like numbers as being abhorrent? It's because foundationally, numbers are foundational. Numbers are foundational. So if you can shake the meaning of numbers, that's why they don't like it, because numbers are objective. Numbers are true. Either they are or they are not. That's why, and I'm just painting this picture, that's what the spirit of the age looks at objective truth with, as if it is something to be destroyed or trifled with the aim of destroying. So the listener is right on the money there. There is no objective metrics used anymore in the science. It's all just narrative. It's all just crafting the spirit of the age. Spirit of the age is narrative. That's all it is anymore.
You know, the ancient Chinese and Arabs that played a very, very important role in the development of mathematics would be surprised to learn that it was their right privilege talking.
Yeah.
That's very well said. This next note, I thought you might like a little more background on remdesivir, in case you haven't already seen this. This drug was originally created and marketed as a treatment for Ebola back around 2014, but it failed to show any real efficacy in any trials, and it was shelved for a while. Then, in order to make up for some of their losses, Gilead initiated trials as a treatment for hepatitis C, but again, it failed to demonstrate any significant efficacy. And Gilead continued to be in the red concerning this medication. Then comes along SARS-CoV-2, and voila, remdesivir was suddenly the treatment of choice, and Gilead began to recoup their losses. Interesting, wouldn't you say? That's from C.H. McCuller Jr., M.D.
We've talked on the show before, it's been a little while, about how markets, as much as we are capitalists, there's one of the idolatrous uses of capitalism is to misapply the same standard of free markets to different industries. And not all every widget is the same. Mm-hmm. A part of the problem, once journalism started going corporate, it was very much part, it's not the only unique variable in its downfall, but that product cannot be produced like a buggy whip. And so once it's more about shareholders and clicks and prices, you can't help but destroy journalism. And I think the same is applying partially to drugs. I think part of this is a relentless pursuit of market share. Healthcare is not meant to be exclusively run by market forces. If it is, you will get this. It'll be about a dollar sign way before it is something about genuine health. Now, again, I'm not strictly opposed to market forces in healthcare or in journalism or anything else, but we are doing an apples bananas things on some level. So that's what came to mind when you read that, Steve, because why would they keep constantly keeping their foot on the gas on this thing otherwise?
Yeah, market forces, pure market forces, even in the industries that you've described, Todd, pure market forces can work if the society in which the market exists is made up of a moral and religious people. The center can't hold when we have what we have now, which is not a moral and religious people, by and large. I can't remember. I think Barna did this research probably over a decade ago about the percentage of professing believers who actually possess something assembly, you know,
it's about 10%, 9 or 10%.
A biblical worldview. That's what we're talking about here. Pure market, because the market is driven by those that are actually buying and selling within the market, all of us. And so if the outcome of the market is evil, or if it's selfish, things like that, just purely driven by market share, you're going to have terrible outcomes. That's the outcomes that you have. I don't think it's really much of a chicken or egg. So these things, as much as anything, go back to revival or bust.
I am 28 years old. I want to believe what you believe about the virus. You seem super sharp, but having grew up in San Diego, I'm starting to realize everyone in my circle post-COVID is absolutely insane, even my parents, and I see us heading in a direction towards communism, and everyone I know seems to have been indoctrinated. Should I get out of here now? It's from Lance.
Probably yes. You know, everybody's got their own story. Getting out of here for one person, it's a Herculean effort for any number of reasons. For the other one, and for a lot more people than those people themselves think, because people have 100 excuses for why it's not possible. But for a lot of people, it's really not that complicated an issue. And this speaks to what Aaron said, if your fundamentals are truly your fundamentals.
Yeah, I can't really add much more to that one.
I think I'll be very brief for me. I think we need to look at where we live the same here domestically, the same way we look at mission trips internationally. New York is a foreign country. California is a foreign country. Unless you are being called specifically to mission in these areas, get the hell out and balkanize with people that where you can create essentially no-go zones for the spirit of the age, where West Virginia and Mississippi at all are as red as California is blue. Even in, or if you can live in a place like California, because that's a massive state. There's plenty of red counties there, right? Make those counties so red that the magistrate won't even bother showing up. Like you avoided where Samuel Adams and the Sons of Liberty lived, because if you showed up with your with your demands, you got tarred and feathered. You just went to the next town over. You know what I'm saying? Balkanize. Unless you're being called to a mission trip, because that's really what states like California are, foreign countries, then get the hell out and balkanize at every opportunity you can to buttress yourself from the spirit of the age.
Yes.
Recently, when you discussed the issues that come up between men and women, I thought about how feminism changed men in America, and not for the better. Men seem to be afraid of being men, don't usually take strong roles in the family. Yes, it's a generalization, but the trend seems widespread. In the last year, the radicals are blaming white men for every evil ill in society. Men don't deserve this. In my experience, men are confused about what role they have. Women want to be strong and often come on too strong. Men used to hold a door open for women. Some still do. If there are two doors, I hold the second one for them. I appreciate men. I see men stand back and almost become invisible while they wait to see what women will do in a relationship. The partnership in a marriage is nearly non-existent, to the point that it's like two people just living together, even in a lot of Christian marriages I see. It can be done, but it's hard to find a real man. Is this a possible show topic? I'd love to hear your thoughts. Nancy Bowman.
Well, this has been a show topic. I mean, we've talked about this both seriously, and this is in many respects, while as kind of a meme of sorts, Steve talks about the dude code. I mean, of course. I just got my worst of the week was a bunch of dudes and rainbow nonsense. I mean, that's why we got, if that did not exist, COVID, to whatever degree COVID's an actual virus that can cause actual damage, we would have dealt with it in an entirely different fashion if we were a nation led by real men. So you know what? That's what this show is every single day. Whether it's as overt as your email made it or not.
Yeah, we've dealt with this. I think we just did last week or 2 weeks ago on the show, and it's I my heart breaks for the women who just can't find just can't find the real dudes. I mean, all of our hearts do to some degree. And I know both of you having multiple daughters, it's like, where to man, Matt? You know, that's probably going to be a conversation, maybe, maybe not, at some point in the near future. But I would say, I would give a reiteration. One, this is one of the first serious conversations that I had with my wife when we were dating, is standards versus expectations. Standard, you got to love Jesus. That's a standard. Okay, there are other standards as well, but that's probably the chief one. Expectations are how you think that that plays out, how that looks like. Expectations, I show my love for Jesus by, I want my wife to love Jesus, and my expectation is that she shows her love by for Jesus by scrubbing the bathrooms two times a week. Now, that's an expectation. That, you know, to some degree, human beings are always going to have those expectations of what things look like, of what their standards look like. So, you know, caution yourself as much as possible with those expectations. But that is not to say, that's not to absolve, you know, as far as what your potential mates might look like, or mate in the future, hopefully just one, looks like in the future. But that doesn't absolve the actual problem and crisis that is, we just don't have enough men. You remember the Mr. Sandman, Mr. Fauci parody that we had a few weeks ago, where that twerp, that little shrimpy kid, went up at some Vaccinate New York event and started singing a parody of Mr. Sandman. It was just an ode to Dr. Fauci. There's a lot of dudes who look like men, who can shave, who may have a deep voice, who may go jet skiing and fishing and do a lot of stereotypically manly things. Deep down, though, they are that kid. So that's kind of an example of standards versus expectations. There may be a lot of guys who look like that kid, but are the exact opposite as well. So that's one thing.
Let's get into boomers. Some of the comments I've said over the years about boomers. I'm going to read these two notes back to back. Okay. This is from Wayne and Pam Howell. As boomers, we can relate to your feelings coming after us. Many boomers went off the rails, but many of us did not. We recall having similar feelings about the generation that came before us, the greatest generation, who lived through the Great Depression and fought World War II. We heard about their day and their music and their culture and how superior it was. We acknowledge sacrifice and bravery of those days, but we do not consider everyone of that time superior to us. On one thing they failed to do was teach us about the specialness of this country. Vietnam, civil unrest, concerns about nuclear war, and assassinations were significant challenges we lived through. Some of us were shaped by this, and others, it is true, did develop, as you say, a Peter Pan syndrome or a refusal to grow up. This is from Beth. Your thoughts concerning the inability of the boomers collectively as a generation to accept age and growing older, I understand the gist of what you're saying. I would disagree in that many instances, it's not deluding oneself that you're older or aging. It's simply that I know I want to keep going on as long as I can. I want to give of myself. I do not want to shove the younger generation out of the way in the process. But in your basic view of accepting one's age, stepping out of the way, just retiring to play golf, etc., sounds to me like death. Time after time, those that do those things just don't live a lot longer. Human beings are generally not built to deal well with the feeling of no longer having earthly purposes while we wait to meet God. So with all due respect, what you describe about our generation sounds too much like giving up to me.
Well, see, you took this personally, and I understand.
Are you talking to me or to her? I'm fine either way.
Her.
Okay. All right. Just
you
to
took this personally, and I understand that to some degree, because you're trying to live a full and rich life. But set aside how that personally applies to you, and just talk about it generationally and this particular generation. And yeah, Steve is dead on. Your time is up, and it should be. Because we are in this mess in many respects because of you. The feats of the greatest generation are all the more amazing because they too had feet of clay, yet they answered the bell. Again, courage is the virtue that gives life to all the rest of them. All right. Those men who jumped off those Higgins boats were terrified. Those women who are left at home to put the pieces back together when their husbands died, terrified. But there was backbone and there was courage. And for whatever reason, those that came behind, many times because you were just exhausted, you put things on cruise control. You probably felt that that was owed to you on some respect. There's all kinds of reasons. But listen, as a generation, yeah, the boomer generation needs to tap out, just like Steve said. Hey, we got all our problems over here on this side too. But you know what? You just whatever you guys got aren't buying green bananas anymore. Go do whatever you want to do, shuffleboard, whatever it is. But you've broken enough stuff.
Wow, that's even harsher than my position. But yeah. Go ahead, Aaron.
So see the conversation we had yesterday about original sin. I think that'll be kind of helpful because yes, you may be a shining example of what individuals can accomplish and can continue to accomplish and have impact in others' lives at this point. But we're talking about that's you. Our criticism of boomers is not meant necessarily for you. Definitely not. It's meant for the generation as a whole. So even though there are always exceptions, and we're all judged individually based on our own characters and character flaws, the generation as a whole, I would agree with what Todd said, the generation as a whole is a spectacular failure. That doesn't mean you were, though, or you are, though. At this point, the generation, from a leadership standpoint, nationally, and even down to the local level to some degree, to some degree, there are always exceptions, but the generation, its time is up from a leadership standpoint.
Yeah. And the it's the ones that are going woke, they are almost there is a cautionary tale. I almost don't mind that they'd stay around. It's pathetic at your age that but it's the ones that are standing in our way. It's the ones that are kind of in common sense return to normal land. But they're like, this is not the way things are done, son. And they're Mike Pence. They're these people. Get out of our way. You're part of the problem. You're lying every single day about the nature of reality to yourself. So we can't get anywhere with you in the positions you're at.
I just think as a general rule, we shouldn't have 80-year-old people running for president of the United States. Period.
Yeah.
I just don't, as a general rule.
Yes.
I just think that, we have age restrictions at a certain point or age accommodations and criteria you have to reach in order to drive, right?
Yeah.
I mean, just not a good idea in general.
Yes.
The idea that there's no one else we could possibly turn to. That there's no one else. There's no one else we could nominate. By the way, again, they stole the last election from him. Absolutely they did.
Yeah.
But there's no one else on planet Earth that could be nominated other than the guy that made the absolute worst decision ever by letting them steal it with COVID lockdowns. With handed his look at the cover to the book. Why do you think I chose this photo? I'm the one that chose this photo. Why did I choose this? He just exited stage left. Here you go, Anthony. Country's all yours. Lord Farquaad, it's all yours. For months, this time last year, this guy ran the country. So there's no one else. No one else who hasn't made these decisions that have friggin' wrecked us. So we're going to do this again when he's 80? The Stones are going back out on tour? Really? I mean, come on, man. More Feedback Friday in a moment. So we've been talking about rough greens for quite a while now, and it's that powder that is rich, dense with vitamins, minerals, nutrients, the things that are missing from your pet's food, stripped out of there when it leaves the factory so that it can stay a long, love you long time there on the store shelves of America. Same thing that they do with the people food. That's why we buy so many supplements today. It's a multi-billion dollar industry. Well, your pet needs one too, and rough greens is it. It's the powder you sprinkle in with the food your dog loves, so all the good things likely missing from that food go right back in. But you may be skeptical that your pet will take to it, will like it. Here's how to find out. We're going to give you that first 14-day jumpstart bag we were previously promoting on the show. We're now going to give it to you for free. You just pay for the shipping. Couple bucks for that. But the bag itself will be free to see if you don't see a difference in your pet in 2 weeks or less. And if they don't end up liking it, to take advantage of this, just go to roughgreens.com, R-U-F-F, for roughgreens.com, or call 833-ROUGH-DOG. That's 833-ROUGH-DOG. This is from Joan, just now, who proves the point that we were just making. I've been a viewer for a short time, but will never watch again with the comment that boomers as a generation need to just go away. That dude with the high voice, think they're talking about you over there, Todd, can go to hell. And I sincerely hope he does not live to retirement.
Thanks.
Indeed, thank you. You are confirming this. Do you know what I think when someone says Gen Xers are too chill, lazy? Nothing. I don't think anything. My name is Steve. I just happened to be born in 1973. I don't friggin' care about my generation on any level. I don't feel the need. I don't identify with it. I don't feel any need whatsoever to defend its honor. It doesn't have an identity to me. Has no idol to me. I don't care. I don't care. So why do you? I'll tell you why you do. Because you believe your generation is special. See, that's how we ended up in this damn mess as a country. Your generation got up one day and said, let's just, you know what? We're just going to wreck everything that was built by every previous generation. We're going to counterculture everything, question everything. That's what happened. The things we used to collectively believe as a country that we still largely believed, even in eras we were deeply divided, like during slavery, Reconstruction. Now we tried to deny certain groups access to those things, right? But collectively, the two groups that were fighting over whether to expand access to those beliefs, did they still largely, though, within their own ecosystem, share a lot of the same value system? Yeah, they did. This generation arose and just wrecked everything. We've never recovered. Did I say Joan Perry wrecked everything? That's who sent us the note. Did I say that?
No.
Did you say that?
No, said the opposite.
No. So Joan, why is your identity as a boomer? There's all this drama right now about the Southern Baptist Convention. I've followed it a little bit. Now, we're actually fellow Christian brothers and sisters, right?
Yeah.
Do you know why I'm not really obsessed with it, though? Because when am I not?
A Southern Baptist.
So I'm just not, I'm aware of it. I'm informed. Yeah. I understand that, you know, this is the largest army we have in American evangelicalism. And if it goes down, it will have a far-reaching consequence in the culture. But like on a personal level, do I like come in and talk about it off the air?
No.
Are we like discussing it in detail? No. Are we like choosing up? I don't even know who the sides are, frankly. I'm not a Southern Baptist. So why do you believe your generation special? What did you guys do? In fact, most of the best music today's Paul McCartney's 79th birthday. Let's be brutally honest. Other than Elvis, most of the best music of that era, which most of us still enjoy in this era, right?
Yeah.
It didn't actually even come from this country.
Right.
The Who, Zeppelin, the Beatles, the Stones, should I go on, came from across the pond. What is this idea that you're so special that we just can't move on without your particular generations just hanging out and hanging on? Remember that video we played earlier this year of that pastor that's just beyond soft-headed? Remember
California.
This? He was just begging the governor for permission to have church.
Yeah.
Didn't he look like he was maybe 70, 75 in that picture, in the video? And my first reaction was, dude, you have, I'm sure, looking at the splendor of your campus, because it looked like a beautiful church, right?
Yeah.
It's clear you have done the Lord's work and he has blessed it on some level, okay? But if at the end of your days and all the striving and suffering that you probably had to go through in order to build a church of that magnitude, and at the end of your days, you're now turning around hat in hand and begging a friggin' filthy, God-hating pagan whether you can open up and worship and preach the word of God, my friend, it is time for you to go. There's no one else. No one else God could call to lead that church. At that, it has to be you. There's no other generation that can do it. It has to be this one. Why do you people think you're special? Joan, why is your identity in with your generation? We goaded you into this. We provoked you, and you took the bait. In 5 seconds, you sent an email that verified all of our complaints. The idea that you have a... Dude... Why do you want to be identified with that generation anyway, if you're any kind of conservative, libertarian, religious, patriot? The generation that gave birth to the rainbow jihad? The generation that gave birth to porn cinema? To the drug culture? You're taking pride in identifying with that?
Can I say something?
In a minute. I ought to be loaded up with emails from people saying, dude, I grew up in that era. I totally agree with you, but I don't know, man. I'm feeling pretty healthy. I'm doing great. I don't know why I need it. I should be getting those. Instead, the first initial response is, how dare you come at me? By golly, I will defend all the honor of all the dope smokers of my generation. That abandoned their kids, divorced routinely, and then when we stayed together, subjected the kids to schools that we didn't monitor at all for a damn generation. How dare you at all? I mean, how dare you associate me with such people? In fact, I'm proud to be associated with them. The Who's saying generation in their mod phase when the band debuted. The song dates back, I believe, to 1966. What year is it?
It's not 1966.
Not that one. Not that one. Now you may say something.
Joan, I'm recruiting people for school board right now. And if they're boomers, and they come to me and say, man, I may have played it safe for too many years, but I got grandkids now and I want to spend my time well and over my dead body. Is this crazy going to be a part of their lives? Buckle up. I'm with you, man.
Amen.
Once more into the breach. I'm looking for those kind of people, but your email is basically the equivalent of you telling me what your pronouns are, and me needing to kneel for them.
Come on now.
And if you think Preach. I'm ever gonna do that, what the hell are you watching this show for?
That's right. Yeah, when you say you've only followed a short time, I'm guessing it's been like 10 minutes. Because I promise you, if it's been longer than that, we've already stepped on 47 of your other shibboleths by now. We've stepped on our own damn shibboleths by now at this point.
But bye, Joan. Thanks for playing.
Where should I go next? Let's do this. A note from New Zealand for you guys. I've been listening to your show for almost a year now, and I think it's a great show, and I want to thank you guys for what you do. There's one thing that is really bothering me. There is so much talk about what people around the world like Fauci have done to human civilization. The question that scares me the most, though, is why? Are they all collectively just terrible at their jobs? Are they all really good at their jobs but working for nefarious entities? I have no way of knowing this. Maybe someone somewhere does. That's from Tracy Zimmerman in New Zealand. The floor now is yours. We're back to where we were originally, where I'm letting you guys go now.
I don't think you can sufficiently answer or understand this question from a purely secular perspective. And this is a theme Steve hit on yesterday, ultimately. You need to go all the way back to the garden and the question of, did God really say? There is a fundamental disagreement with what reality is, a hatred of that reality, and a desire to do and say anything to reject it. You can't possibly see the consequences of all of that. The devil himself could not. It didn't matter. He didn't care. He wanted to destroy all that was good and true and beautiful anyways, because he came to resent that he wasn't the author of it and somebody else was. There's no way to answer your question without starting there. I'll leave Aaron to fill in any other blanks, because I know for certain he agrees with that part.
Indeed. I think the first part, when we're talking about massive events like this, or even small details that end up having a domino effect on the way that the world is run or that societies operate, in the period of time in which we find ourselves in Western civilization, I think the first step in understanding why the enemy does the things, or pawns of the enemy do the things the way that they do, the first step in answering the question, why are they doing that? To what ends are they doing that? Is to understand that from their perspective, there is no why. At best, it's a profit motive. At worst, it's something else. But just as you wouldn't say to a dog that's barking in your neighborhood all night, why are you barking? Why do you keep barking? The dog's just gonna look at you. I'm a dog. I bark. It's what I'm doing. I'm a dog. These people are pawns of the spirit of the age. They are wired to do things, whatever their motive might be. They are wired to do things to acquire power. So there is no why. There is no grand cabal of people, grand conspiracy. There is no Hillary Clinton colluded with George Soros in order to create pipelines to smuggle kids into Jeffrey. Now, that might be true. Who knows? But I don't think the point is there's no grand cabal of people. There is a spirit of the age using pawns to collect power. And whatever the outcome may be the same as that grand cabal conspiracy. And in fact, it probably will be. But we have to understand what I'm really saying is, what we're up against is what we talked about in the first segment. The enemy here is the spirit of the age. It uses whatever it needs to acquire power. Whether that's science, cooking the books, fudging the numbers, creating false premises, drawing conclusions before collecting data, whatever it needs to do. So the why, really, from their perspective, is irrelevant, because the outcome is the same. The acquisition of power and control over you.
Really nice. It's too long for the time we have, but I wanted to mention it here at the end. A really nice note from Sarah Mortimer in Moscow, Idaho, about how much she loves our show. And she wanted to make a suggestion to our audience, because we're getting a lot of people that are emailing us. Hey, we've never thought about our faith or the Bible or anything the way that since we've heard the way you guys can, you know, kind of bring it into a contemporary construct. And her and some of her friends started a Facebook group just with their own church Bible study. It's grown to 27,000 members. All right. And if you're interested in just getting together with a group of people and going through the Word of God for the first time or the next time, their website is totheword.com. Again, that's totheword.com. So I just wanted to give a shout out to Sarah and throw that out there to people that have been intrigued by some of the things we do on Theology Thursday. If you want to go deeper or further on your own, that's one avenue for you to do this. And then I want to close with this email from Sheila, who I think says it very well. Unlike the person who was upset with your remarks about the boomer generation, I'm a boomer and I think you're spot on. So many of us cannot let go of the past and somehow believe the music, drug use, promiscuity, protest, and counterculture are better and more noble than the previous generation that was called the greatest. They still think we're the cool kids, even though we're now in our 70s. I'm not one of them, so preach on. I mentioned the other day when I was flying through Chicago that I was not wearing my mask in the airport. And then what did I tell you when you asked me how many people were wearing your masks in the airport? What did I tell you? It wasn't many, but I remember I said I was probably the youngest one who wasn't. That is an infer. What did I infer by saying that? That primarily the others who were defying the masquerade were therefore, since I'm going to be 48 years old in a month,
right?
That would mean then who were the other, pretty much everybody else that was defying this were who?
A boomer.
Hmm. I thought aren't we arguing against critical racist theory on the notion that people shouldn't be put into collective groups and have sins they didn't committed cast upon them, right?
That's right. What I was referencing earlier.
Yeah, I guess I would think I'd be eager to differentiate myself from the prevailing winds of my generation.
Yes.
And by the way, I have done so. How did I go from community college and Michigan State flunk out to one of the largest platforms in the country? Because frankly, a lot of people in the Gen X generation are soft, are lazy, are lackadaisical, are passive, and I outwork their asses. That's how.
Yeah.
Okay? Should I? That's why I'm not offended when people point those stereotypes out about that generation. It's true. My success is a living embody of it. I sought to differentiate myself from it rather than succumb to it, right?
Yes.
I thought that's what we kind of did here in America.
Food for thought, John.
John 3:17.